So let us start in prayer in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and in the hour of our death. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Saint Mary, Mother of the Church, Mother of Families, pray for us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
So welcome to this Discipleship night, that this happens to be the last of the year, right? You see this brochure, Maturing in Love. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
It's strange. Okay. Let's see if it's working. Coming and going? Okay. So Maturing in Love. I don't know. Now it's better?
Yes.
Okay. So Maturing in Love, because your children are called to love, we want to help them discover and live out their vocation. So this is the last of the year, right? We started in October last year, and this was toward a family-friendly parish, right? Now next month, in October, we start a new program, and it will be toward a family and friendly parish, right? So we have been working to be family friendly. Now we're going to be, this new year, enemies of the family, right? Just to change a little bit the thing. Now we will start a new program and wait for surprises. We will walk toward a family fully alive, preparing for Philadelphia, the world meeting of families. So it will be a great year, deepening, you know, in the same truth that the family is the path of God toward us, the family is the path chosen by God for us, okay? So today we are going to work in this way. I will speak 10 minutes, and then Father Javier will speak 15 minutes. We will have some questions, we'll discuss, and at the end Father Armando will speak another 15 minutes, so we'll have small pieces, okay, different priests, but we will deal with the same topic. Maturing in love, I will give an introduction, very brief. Love is a path, and then Father Javier will speak about how love is not just a feeling, but it's something else, it's a feeling, but it's something more. It's called to be forever, not just for one day, for one week, for one year. And then Father Armando will speak about temperance. So Father Javier will be speaking about fortitude. Love endures forever. And Father Armando will speak about temperance, how we need to purify our love and to desire one thing with our whole heart, you know. So first of all, just a brief introduction about love as a path. Many times we understand love as, you know, I look at my wife, she's so beautiful, she looks at me, I am so wonderful, and that's love, right? We look at each other, and that's it, right? But love is a path. I remember this kind of, I don't know, joke or whatever, or story about this engaged couple, you know, that they were about to get married, and, you know, they didn't have money, so what are we going to do? We have a house, a small apartment, but we don't have money. And she said, you know what, I will live just looking at you, you can eat, and I will look at you, and that will be enough for me, okay? Okay, you say, okay, so they got married, and the first day it was okay, he was eating because he was working hard, and she was looking at him, oh, you know, and the second day, okay, the third day, still she was looking at him, but then after a week, you know, he was start eating, you know, and then she said, oh, please give me something, you know, give me something of this bread at least or something. And then he said, well, you said, you know, that you will leave just looking at me and seeing me will be enough. And she says, well, now I cannot see you anymore, you know. I cannot see you, I cannot leave. So we have this romantic vision of I look at you and you look at me, but love is a path. We are not called to remain looking at each other, but love is a path. So to be married is to receive the yoke of Christ, right? And the yoke, you know, like the comparison with the animals is not very nice, but the yoke has place for two, right? The yoke is like the two animals will go, right, with the yoke. And the point is that we have a common horizon. So we look at the same point, we walk together toward the same horizon. It's not that we stay here just looking at each other, enjoying each other. This would be very selfish, right? But we have a mission, we have a common horizon, we walk together. That's marriage, is receiving the joke, not the joke, right? So marriage is not a joke, but it's a yoke. So we receive the yoke of Christ and we walk toward the same horizon, because God, Jesus Christ, is inviting us to work in this direction. So just now Father Javier will invite us to deepen in the path of love as a path of fortitude, okay? Because love is not called to be just for one night or for one week, you know? There is this beautiful idea, you know, it's a Cardinal Scola, he's an Italian cardinal, and he was close to be the Pope. He was one of the names, right, when there was, before Pope Francis, there was this one of these cardinals, you know, in Italy. And he has this great point, you know, to the youth, to the young adults. I invite you to try to do this. Look at your girlfriend, look at your boyfriend, and tell him or tell her, I love you, but not forever. And then she will just, you know, I love you, but not forever. Then you don't love me, right? There is something in her heart that says, if you love me, but not forever, is that you don't love me, really, you know? Love needs this forever. Otherwise, something is missing. I mean, we are not doing giving a lot of reasons, but there is this experience in our hearts that if love is not forever, then something is missing to this love, right? So now Father Javier will speak about fortitude in love and how love is not just a feeling, but something else, something more.
Yeah, I wanted to talk about a little bit this extremely important virtue. That's it, courage or fortitude, has both names. There are four, we call it four cardinal virtues. Cardinal, because it's like the directions there comes from the Latin word cardo cardinis, which means like the main street and the main, like the hinge in a door. If you have in a door, it's a good hinge, it can open or close. The same with these four cardinal virtues. One is justice, temperance, of which Father Armando will talk in a second, fortitude, and prudence. Without these virtues, we cannot have a good human moral life, and we can't even have a Christian life. Our faith is going to build upon these pillars, or the pillars, and we can see it very well. I mean, we are now in the basement. Take away one of these pillars and the whole building is going to collapse. Same with these four cardinal virtues. The one of fortitude, or courage, as you prefer, it's important because cowardice is like termites. I mean, the same here. Sometimes some buildings, some of the pillars go away because of if we had a kind of a wooden one, all built upon wood. If we get the termites, that's the cowardice. It's going to collapse. Fortitude is the virtue that underpins any other virtue. Without it, we cannot have any other. We cannot grow. We cannot have this kind of, we cannot mature in love. Even in the book of Revelation, the last book of the Bible, and let me use one of my, I have the Bible, but I found it, the quote talks at the very end saying, as for cowards, the unfaithful, the depraved, murderers, the unchaste, sorcerers, idol worshippers, and deceivers of every sort, their lot is in the burning pool of fire and sulfur, which is the second death. So, puts St. John, the author of the book of Revelation, puts at the same level all these cowardice, idol worshippers. So, it's kind of a serious sin. Jesus Christ was a perfect example of two courageous men. He was able to withstand all the attacks and the kind of the comments on the kind of animosity from the Pharisees. But you may ask, what is the definition of courage? And taking it from the Catechism of the Catholic Church, there's a section about virtues and a few numbers about these human cardinal virtues. And then the Catechism talks about the theological, faith, charity, and hope. But talking about fortitude, the Catechism is speaks in these terms, saying, is the moral virtue that ensures firmness in difficulties and constancy in the pursuit of the good. It strengthens the resolve to resist temptations and to overcome obstacles in the moral life. The virtue of fortitude enables one to conquer fear, even fear of death, and to face trials and persecutions. It disposes one even to renounce and sacrifice his life in defense of a just cause. Jesus Christ himself insisted, and we can remember that parable about the sower bringing the seed. There's some of the seed fell in a place where there were thorns, saying, oh, immediately it got it with joy, but they were not able to resist the temptations and the anxieties, Jesus says, of life, and they choke it. So it's kind of first moment of acceptance of faith or acceptance of truth, of grace, but it's kind of easy, but without fortitude, it won't last, and it won't last our resolution for love. What is so many times drawing us of courage? Because, again, it's not always a popular virtue or something we talk about all the time. Sometimes we talk about other characteristics about which are important, kindness, mercy, fine. But courage goes sometimes under the radar. First, something very common in our society, I think, is cynicism. I've been practicing that. Always, no matter how many times I practice that, it's going to again. Cynicism. That's a kind of looking alive from the side, from a very comfortable place, always assuming the worst, and always kind of avoiding any action. The cynic, by definition, is the one who says, well, judges about everything, criticizes everything, has a word about everything, but does nothing. That's a perfect cynic. Another thing that is quite challenging, and Jesus already talked about it, evidently, it was a very materialistic views. So present, especially in our Western world, in which everything is about comfort, everything is about kind of security, personal kind of relax and all that. And without, you see, without fight, fight, that's it. Maybe avoid it. Without a fight, without kind of self-discipline, without self-denial, impossible to grow this or any kind of virtue. And there's another thing still that it's against courage, which is fear. That's definite. There are two kinds of fear. A very biblical one, the first, the fear of the Lord, which is a gift from the Holy Spirit. Fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, which it means basically not to be afraid of God and His punishment. It means to acknowledge who God is, what's His power, and being afraid of offending Him. Fear of the Lord is, I'm afraid and truly afraid of losing His friendship, not of Him punishing me. But there's another fear, and this is quite common. Fear could be fear of people say, fear of public opinion, fear of fear of man. I think that's a term used by the Bible, if I remember it right. Fear of man. But sometimes fear of, yes, possible, but not really very probable circumstances. What if I say this and this person is going to think that? What if people getting married? What if I get married with this person and it's going to cheat on me? What if I try to kind of to pray more, but then at the end I don't find it? What if that's huge enemy of this courage. And courage, this energy pursuing what is right, what is good. Where do we find it? It's emotion, people are, it's very courageous because it's on fire. Is that courage? It's in the mind. Where is courage? You know, the Greeks had a name or a term for this. We call it the themos. Themos. And it's present in English word that's thermos, a place, a thermos where you keep your coffee warm. A themos is, according to the Greeks who already talk about this, it's like your chest and lungs. Courage is a virtue, not just like emotions of your feelings, not just intellectual. Like I know, courage is not about knowing what is right. That's a condition, of course, because you need to do what is right, to be courageous to do what is right, what is good. But it's not enough. It's in that union. I mean, of course, we know that's not physically, we're not talking just physically, it's way of speaking, but isn't it true that, for example, when we need to make a decision or take courage or do something that is not pleasant, we take a deep breath? Probably it's because of that the Greeks were talking about this themis, which is this place, the chest and the lungs, union, the mind and the emotions. So to get the next step and risk for what is right, sacrifice for what is right. Our belief in God it really fosters, really gives meaning and strength to courage, or gives possibility for courage to be. St. Paul, writing to his disciple Timothy was a disciple of St. Paul, you know, Titus and Timothy He was a young man and was entrusted with the episcopacy. He became a bishop. And in the letters, St. Paul was saying, don't let anybody disrespect you because of your youth. And he wrote, because the spirit that God gave us is not craven, cowardly, timid, but one of strength, love, and self-discipline. There's three elements. Strength, love, self-discipline come together. So Timothy needed this kind of a little bit of a push because he saw it's not easy to be a priest, even less to be a pastor, imagine to be a bishop. So 2,000 years ago and today, we have not received spirit of cowardice. We have not received, that's St. Paul talking to the Colossians, you have not received a spirit of cowardice. You receive the spirit of the children of God. And finally, as we were talking before, there is no love, there is no growth in love without this important virtue. First of all, really the virtue of courage is going to expand our life, or the lack of it is going to make it smaller, our life. Because it's the one who is going to be able to make us join a good cause. Without this desire, knowledge of what is good, and courage of doing it, we're never going to join those important causes, those important kind of missions that require sacrifice. And for love is the most important area of our life where sacrifice, where courage, where self-denial, self-discipline is required. Not for just a kind of normal love of like a normal kind of friendship or the familiar, like to be colleagues. Yeah, that probably doesn't require that much love. Not even for a moment of sexual relation. Okay, that there is love there, but doesn't require a lot of courage. Maybe yes, to kind of overcome some timidity here or being shy, but that's all. Or not for normal friendship. But when we are talking about agape, the love Christ is talking about, some moments in the gospel saying there is no greater love than the one who gives up to lay down their own life for their own friends. That's the kind of love that's going to require a lot of sacrifice, a lot of dying to oneself, and ultimately requires courage. So, different saints had different qualities. Different saints performed different missions in the church, but some were like, wow, missionaries. Like yesterday we celebrated the feast of St. Peter Claver, a Jesuit who became a missionary, who according to the biographies, he over 40 years he baptized 300,000 people, ministering to the slaves coming from Africa into what is now Colombia. But we have saints like Saint Teresa of Lisieux, never left her convent once she entered there, and didn't perform those acts. But they all share in this courage for doing what is good. We have plenty of good examples. So I prepare just some questions. The first would be, you want to share and help one another. It's how in your life you learn to mature in love. The things that you have seen looking back, how God, through circumstances of your life, has helped you. How do you see this, what we have said, that courage underpins all the other virtues? And what is the difference between courage and having a strong will? Someone who gets his goals, is that the same as courage? Like, for example, an example from history, Hitler. Was he courageous? Hitler? Adolf Hitler. Especially at the beginning of the war. A strong leadership. They conquered half of Russia, all of Europe, and smart, and he got his goals. Especially this part of his life. Was he courageous? Yes or no? For example, what's the difference between having a strong will and having courage? And finally, in general also, if it is love, something that can be taught, or is just something that has to grow, like we cannot tell apple tree to bring pears or melons there. So nothing we can do with that. It's the same with love, that will grow or not, can be taught.
Good evening to everyone. So we are going to talk now about desires. It's important that we understand the virtues in a whole. They are not virtues. One virtue without the other don't exist. The first of all virtues is prudence. Prudence means using the reason for what I am going to do. Because the reason is the one who gives me the truth of my action. And so it's very important, it's the first of all the virtues, because control give a measure better to the rest of the virtues. The other virtues are, all then is, first is self, we are going to temperance. It's about desires. Fortitude, that Father Javier was talking. It's about difficulties. And justice, that is the goal of all virtues. That is given to each one what he deserved or what is worthy to him. All virtues are connected with one thing that is good. That is the reason a strong will is not a fortitude. Why? Because a strong will can be for evil, for example, and that is not a virtue. Virtues are not single actions that we do. Virtues are habits that we create inside us and make us easy, quicker, and with joy our actions. So they are like spiritual muscles inside us. It's like a person who walk, and more you walk, more stronger are your muscles in your legs, and less effort you have to do for walking. The same in spiritual life. The problem of all these are that not feelings or emotions, are all choices. Without a choice is not a growth in the virtues, a maturity in love. We are talking about virtues, why? Because maturity in love is growing in virtues. And the problem is how we are desiring this growth. Being human means to desire to grow. In the moment I am not in that desire, and that is not the goal of my life, a lot of problems are going to be in my life. Why? Because you are human, and that's what we have to teach to our children. And that is the only way I can keep myself in the way of love. Understanding that I am here, and I am a human person, because through my choices, I can grow. And I have the possibility, the capacity of growing. And now all virtues are connected. These are choices about actions or acts that I choose according to reason, that means prudence, that help me to grow as a man, help me to grow in the relationship with the others. Why? Because without justice cannot be friendship and cannot be love. That is what we are talking at the end. You need all the virtues for loving. In fact, Aristotle said that it's impossible to be friendship in those who don't have virtues. So it's important for us, for our marriage is a kind of friendship. So we have to work there. All they are about good. The desire is very simple. What you desire always, what is good? It's connected. You cannot define good without desire, and you cannot define desire without good. They are in connection. Desire is related to good, and good is related to desire, for to love. Some goods have a difficulty for achieving them, and that is the call for fortitude. When I have to face the difficulty of embracing some good, or gaining some good, or achieving some good in my life. It has a dimension of what I was talking. One is facing evil, because it's some dimension. The difficulty is some kind of evil. So there is not only good. In fortitude is facing evil in my action, because there are some actions that I have to face, for example, the effort. Laziness is because I don't want to make the effort of putting myself to do my work, or instead I keep myself procrastinating or doing other things, because there is a difficulty, there is an effort. There is some evil that means that I have to overcome that evil. And there is, but the virtue, and the other is when the evil is coming and I have to resist it, to endure it, and it's more connected with the virtue of patience. But there are hinges, because all the other virtues depend on these four. And it's like the door is holding in those hinges, and it's a big thing, but the hinges are those who support and let the door to move and to be there, and to walk, work as a door. And so the same thing is with virtues. They are patient is when the evil is coming. We are impatient, why? Because something evil is happening, I don't like it, and I get upset or I get angry. But all the virtues are trying to bring the good. The greater is the good, the greater is the desire. So that is the point of where all the virtues, the greatest good is love. But in the moment we are not working our desires, we cannot grow in love. Why? Because we have, all of us, we have a lot of selfish desires. And we have to have a control of our desires. This is the temperance, it's also self. Javier was talking about discipline, self-control. That is temperance. If I don't control my desires, I cannot be just, I cannot love the others. It's not difficult, it's impossible. So how I control them? Why control my desires? Because I am looking for a greater good. I don't control my desires because I have to punish me or I want to sacrifice myself. No, I control my desires because I want something that is greater, that is better. And so I control this selfish desire that is bringing me to something that is a little good. And we choose always, and these virtues are always for, I repeat it, for justice and for love, for friendship. More we grow in virtues, more able we are to love the others. The control of the desires is something that is always coming in the letter of St. Paul. Why? Because we have to put one desire above all the other desires. In Christian heart, it's very easy to understand. Other people may have more problems to understand this. First is the desire of God. That is the first commandment, to love God with all my heart, all my strength, all my being, and all my soul. Because that love, that is the only love that is all capable of fulfilling my existence and giving me happiness, because good also, all the desires are connected with the desire of happiness. Happiness is the greatest the ultimate good. For us Christians, must be easy to understand that happiness can be only in God. That is the reason of the first commandment. But now I have a way for going toward God. Yeah? He is the ultimate good or the greatest good. That good that contains in itself all the other goods, because he is the creator. But at the same time, I have a way for going toward God. I cannot go toward God, toward the greatest good, if I don't look to other good concrete that God is giving me, that is the other people, the other persons that are around me. Because love is always between persons, between people. You cannot have love, true love, with an animal. You can have an affection with the animal, but not true love. Because love implies some dimension that I'm not going to talk about there now, but it means a mutual love and a freedom. Without freedom and without choices, it's impossible to love. But what is important to understand is that temperance is because I want to be happy, I control my desires. We are unhappy, we are sad, we are upset, we are angry, because we don't control many times our desires. And that is one of the greatest problems in this society, that we are in a consumistic society, and consumerism is the way we live. We want something, we take it. Instead of using our reason, understanding, is that going to help me to grow as a man? Is that going to help me to grow in love? Is that going to approach me to God in a deeper way? No, we don't think. We don't use our intelligence. We follow our desires spontaneously without any self-control, self-discipline, for happiness, I mean. Because the goal here is always achieving the fullness of my existence and the union of love with the one who is love in itself, that is God, that is a person. And that is the your desires, all you desire it because you are looking for a good that is able to fulfill your life and your existence. But the problem of this is, you know, there is an expression, it's a very strong expression, I know it, that is too much sometimes to hear these things, but I think it's Galatians, it's the verse 24 or 25, I'm not sure. After talking about the Holy Spirit, the gifts, the fruits of the Holy Spirit, after talking about being moved by the Spirit, and living according to the Spirit, and the beautiful fruits of the Spirit that are joy, love, peace, patience, amability, kindness, self-control, humility, these are the fruits of the Spirit. After talking about the fruits of the Spirit, that I think is 24, in the verse 25, St. Paul says, the one who is in Christ has crucified his desires and passions. Why? Because he's looking for God and he's surrendering any desire that I have to the union with God. And it's the way, why? Because here is happiness. The problem is that we don't believe in truth, because our faith is sometimes very little, that only in God is my happiness. And that is the reason we follow many times different desires that at the end destroy us. Because what controls your life, the life of your children, the life of your family, is only one thing, is your desires. So if I don't have a control of my desires, I cannot grow as a person, because it's impossible. I mean, this goes before this. You cannot have, we would say there is an order, because everything that moves you is because you desire it. So it's, you love it, because it's something good, attract you and draws you to that thing. But the problem is how I control now my desires, how I ordain my desires for justice, for love, for growing as a person, because it's the same good thing. I grow as a person in the measure I am growing in my capacity of loving the others. And this is a battle of every day, this is not a one-day battle. No, we are here in this world only for one reason. Is for growing in love. It's the reason God has put us in this world, for tasting each day in a deeper way the God himself, who is happiness. in a way that is loving the others, because you cannot separate this from the love of God. There, the second commandment is similar to the first commandment. But you need the virtues. Without the virtues, you cannot live. It's true that when you love God above all things, charity is the mother and form of all the virtues. It's able to generate every virtue. But I have to love God with all my heart, all my strength, all my being, and all my soul. That is not so easy, because many times we, that a love of God, that desire of God, that desire of the union with God, we are not looking for it. We are looking for many other things in our lives. And that is the reason we are, because you cannot, why I look for God, for good? Because I look for my fullness. You cannot stop looking for your fullness and for your perfection. It's impossible. Because what is good? What good is the thing that perfect me and make me more perfect as a person? That is good. So in the measure you are looking for good, depend on what kind of good you are choosing. You have to renounce to some goods, to some desires, for others that are better. And this is one of the biggest problems in our education of children, because educating a child is teaching the child to choose well. So to have the teaching a child and educating a child is teaching him to control his desires, so he looks for a greater good. But
that's greater.
He looks for a greater good that fulfills his heart. And this is a problem. If we don't teach this to our children, they are going to be confused, because there are a lot of desires inside us, affections, emotions that are moving, and all the advertisement and all the TV is working through desires. They are trying to create, you know, different kinds of desires. If I don't teach my children to rejoice in a greater good, they are going to be confused and mistaken, and they are going to fall in, as majority of them have big problems, because they are not able to surpass the immediate desire. They are not able to use fortitude, because they are connected, you cannot separate them. Fortitude, but now I deny this desire, this is a difficulty, because I am looking for a greater desire. But what controls our lives is our desires. Have this very clear. You are not moved by this, you are moved by your desires, every one of us. And every person you see in this world is moved by his, her desires. The problem is, what are my desires, and what is the good I am looking for? Because every desire, I repeat, is connected with good. The problem is where you are putting happiness, because good is also in an interrelation with happiness. Something is good because you think it's going to bring you more happiness. You think that something is going to make you unhappy, you will never think that that is good. You think that something is good because you think that it's going to make you more happy. And this is a problem. People are choosing wrong things because they are looking for happiness in a wrong way. And the problem is that we, you know, there is a book, the person of the, is about happiness is the responsibility, no, the of happiness. Well, he has a statement in the book that he said that the greatest argument for atheist, agnostic, against God are the people who are in the church. Why? Because we are not happy. And it's true. Why? Because we are putting happiness in many places that are not God. Because when a person in reality and in truth is putting his good only and his desire only in God, that person, God, fulfills his heart. Why? Because that is what God does with those who put their desire in God. I mean, I'm also understanding that I cannot go toward God if I don't fulfill the second commandment, that is, love the others as God loves me. It's a battle always, and every day. But it's the battle for growing, it's the battle for happiness, it's the battle for joy, it's the battle for peace, and we have to battle it every day. Because when I'm not focusing my life in growing, I am destroyed as a man. My life has no meaning, no meaning. Now I can go to selfish desires, can be anything, watching TV, playing games, things. But there are things that are not fulfilling your humanity, because your humanity is only fulfilled when you grow here, grow in love, and grow in the union with the one who is able to fulfill our lives, only Him. And that is, the maturing in love is about that. It's about where is happiness and how to achieve it. But it's a battle every day, because you are choosing every day, and through your choices, you are choosing who is your God, what is good for you, and what is happiness. And you are choosing to be a man of justice, a man of love, and a man of generosity and fortitude, or we are choosing other kind of people. And maturing is growing, it's the same thing. And a father has the mission of making their children grow in, and mature in virtues. So virtues is when this reason grasps my desires, involve, penetrate, and pervade my desires, pervade the fear to facing evil, and also make me generous in the action with others. But it's the reason who is controlling, because we are people and we can make choices because we have an intelligence, we have a reason that is able to make me understand that is a greater good, better than this immediate satisfaction. But this is the problem of this society. The biggest problem of this society is this, that people are choosing always in the indulgent with myself, being eating this, doing this. I mean, it's bad that, no, it's not bad. The problem is that you are creating a kind of behavior that is a hindrance for achieving greater goods. And you cannot, in truth and in death, rejoice and have the peace and the joy and the happiness of virtues. Aristotle, that was not a Christian, understand very clear that in this life, happiness is the capacity I have of creating virtues inside me. My virtues are my happiness, it's the same, it's not different. The point is that we are in a society that this has nothing to do with the mind of this society, but that happiness is connected with these things. No, virtues are prudence, fortitude, temperance, and justice. They are in they are connected with the body. And the one who rules your action is prudence, because it's acting according to what is the true good. Only my reason can say me what is the true good, because my feelings many times deceive me, are deceitful desires. I mean, you have a lot of deceitful desires, but this is the reason the people are so unhappy, they have so lack of meaning in life, they are so boring in their lives. Why? Because they are choosing wrong. They are following their desires, and their desires are putting them in emptiness, loneliness, and lack of meaning in life. But the point is that we choose. Always, and we are choosing. We cannot escape from this, we will say, state of humanity. That is, I have to choose. Every day you are choosing. And you're choosing not things. That is the important point about virtues. Because virtues is the way you grow as a man. You are choosing about your humanity. And everything you do, you are choosing the kind of person you are. And you cannot avoid that, because it's the way God has made us. And nobody can avoid that. We are choosing when we are there. What I recommended here is when you go to prayer, that is a practical issue, increase your desire of God. More you increase your desire of God, the more able you will be to face other desires that are contrary to your growth. How I increase my desire of God? Loving Him. How I love God? Making acts of love. How I make an act of love? Saying it, using your words and your mind and your heart. My God, I love you. I desire you. You are my happiness, my joy, my fullness, and my only delight. I want to be in union with you. You can move your heart what you want in your prayer. More you move in charity, more you are moving and letting God to work in you. But I mean, more you increase the desire of God, more you will experience the love of God, and at the same time, more you will desire Him, and so more able you will be of self-control, controlling, and having discipline in the other desires that don't help me to grow. I mean, it's a point of happiness. It's understanding where is happiness. When you go to prayer and you don't put happiness in God, you are very mistaken. Because charity, in the words of Thomas Aquinas, is not any kind of friendship with God. You know, when I have a friendship with a person, I share with that person something always. Charity is a friendship with God in which He shared with me His beatitude, so His happiness. So, but many times, loving God with charity is not loving God because He is wise or powerful or almighty. No, it's loving God because He is beatitude, so infinite happiness in itself, in Himself, and also the source of every happiness. That is loving God with charity. But we don't do many acts of that. But that is loving God with charity. You cannot love God with charity in any other way. Bethany is asking Mary that she loves God, and all her desires were toward Him, who was able to fulfill them, so He fulfilled them always. That is, she is called full of grace, is full of the love of God, to help us to grow in our desire of God, and in our desire of loving the others, understanding that is the way of going to the union with God, because every happiness, every joy, every peace that you are looking for, you know what you do, it's only in Him. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and in the hour of our death. Amen. I'm reminded that we don't are, God is not very far from us, He's inside us, we are His temple, He indwells in our hearts. And we pray in the glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.